Thank you very much, John. I'm sure people will have lots of questions, and we are going to have an opportunity after this, in conversation with Stewart Helm and Chantal Joffe, to open up to the whole audience questions that have come up through the afternoon. So we look forward to that. I'll just introduce, first of all, Chantal, who was born in Vermont and lives and works in London. She studied at the Glasgow School of Art and the Royal College of Art, and has a forthcoming solo exhibition at the Jewish Museum in New York, the Gerwood in Hastings, and at the National Gallery here, Natural Portrait Gallery here, with Ishmael Myerscough, and that's all 2015-2015. You're represented by Victoria Miro Gallery and Chamin Reid in New York, with whom you're also having a forthcoming solo show. Stewart was born in Hertfordshire and lives here in London and in Buenos Aires. Stewart graduated from MA at Royal College of Art and also studied at Maidstone College of Art, BA. He's recently exhibited in Natural Selection at the Fine Arts Society and has exhibited regularly at Timothy Chu Gallery in Atlanta since the 1990s. He was included in Whitechapel Open, British Drawing Hymned Annual 1982 and New Contemporaries the same year. As well as group exhibitions in the UK and USA, he was commissioned for the Wellcome Foundation and has collaborated on a number of commissions, including collaboration with architect and designer Nigel Coates. So, just a brief intro to you guys both. I think we'll just start with some questions. Given that this exhibition takes Egon Schiele as the trigger for looking at the representation of the naked figure, I thought we should start with a question to you both, which was really, what was it about Schiele that influenced you, as it did when you were a student?
Well, for me, the first thing I liked about Schiele was that he was the first person I saw that he looked like he might have had actual sex with the people he was drawing. There was a sexuality there that I didn't find in other things. He gave the body a breadth of kind of grubbiness and solicitness and all those things that I was interested in. And so that really was the trigger for me. And I also saw his work as maps. They were maps to draw you around to the psyche of his sitter. They were little routes. You know, his drawings aren't straightforward life drawings. They're bits of both, bits of his mental state, the model's mental state, and what he's looking at. And it was that I liked more than anything.
So for you, Chantal, you've had a fascination with Schiele since you started as a young artist, and indeed you've got postcards in your studio, and you also mentioned in the catalogue in your conversation with Gemma Blackshaw that you say this you mentioned that he is the ultimate, he becomes the ultimate. And what do you mean by that?
Can you say that again? He becomes the what?
So becomes the pencil.
Pencil,
yes.
I think that's what the shirt talked about a week ago, but I was reminded of everything that had excited me when I first saw him when I was about 19. But I mean, I thought I was interested in the conversation before about whether he was sexually excited. I think he was excited as much by his own nakedness as by the nakedness of the women, I think the drawings reflect that intensity of his excitement. He quivers with a kind of, for me anyway, through the drawings, with his own sort of, he's sexually excited to be naked and to be drawing himself. And he's so excited to be drawing himself, and he can hardly get the drawings down with excitement and the kind of seeing the outline of himself, I don't know, the newness of himself, the newness of drawing himself and his own youth and his own bony beauty, and I suppose that's what I mean.
And like him, you do actually work from life as well as from other sources. Can you talk a little bit about, you made this beautiful piece here, which, and actually maybe you do focus on women and people you know and family and your children. And when we invited you to make a new piece for this show in response to it, you made a male figure, which was quite surprising for us. Can you just say a little bit about is there an intimacy between you and the model or subject?
Yeah, it's quite part of that. It's funny looking at it and having looked at the Sheila, it seems so tame compared to the even. I mean, I think everything was pretty tame. The sort of wild honesty of this work, and I look at that, that seems quite cozy or something. And, I mean, anyway, I mean, it's always hard to see work.
But when you were at college, you were liking Sheila, frustrated with the life class, with having to draw from the life model. How did you deal with that? How did you combat that? What happened? Did you have?
Well, initially I asked a friend of mine who's a transvestite to come and sit with me, and that was.
Can you please speak up?
I asked a friend who's a transvestite to come and sit with me, and that it just was a man in a dress that was pretty tame. So I got porn mags to try and really just to paint nakedness, really, and to paint sex, but really nakedness, because they were a really ready source of naked people and sort of frolicking and stuff. And that was for a while quite exciting and interesting.
And also photography, excuse me, was an important source of material, wasn't it?
Well, I look at photographers a lot. I love that. That was very useful.
Was that because it was a way of a sort of distance between you and the figure, or a way to
looking at?
Well, using the photographic image and the pornographic.
Well, more that you can get people to do things for a photograph. I don't have Egon Schiller's kind of ability to be so, you know, to get people to do those things, so maybe it was just a way of getting those drawings.
Stuart, did you have, what was your starting point? All your work is using the figure and has been for a long time.
It's never from life, it's always from imagination, but other aspects of life come into it. It's not direct, but it's a diary for me, really. Mm. So they're all diaries of what's going on around me, and which isn't particularly that unrelated to Sheila, because I think everything that was going on in Vienna at the time is in his drawings, you know. And especially women's first empowerment to be physically enjoying sex, to be able to show their genitals in a way that might elude you to feel that they might have made the decision to do it. And my work, I think, has more in tune with Nancy and Leon in the fact that it's about history and about the need to make man, to make a figure, to make an image of oneself, for it to be a fundamental function of just existing, to make representation of other figures, which I don't think Sheila particularly has, because he began with a nude, but he's certainly in there.
And your images, which are behind us in there, are always a multitude of figures, the male figure, spread across the page, and you work from all different scales. What is it? I mean, they almost look like a deluge, and they have a sort of biblical sense to them as well. Is there a direct reference to things like the biblical, spirituality, etc.?
Well, they're always about things like plague and death and habit, more than anything. It's habit I like. I like the habit of making drawings. I like the habit of having a pencil, and I like to sort of empty myself before I make a drawing. It's what it gives to me rather than. So when I start, I'm complete, there's nothing in my head. So then that's kind of where I want to be. I want to be empty, and I want the thing to give something back to me. So in whatever form they take, it's that that I'm searching for, that kind of freedom and emptiness, that almost relaxation about the need to draw. There is no point being made other than Anne's need to constantly draw. And I think people have always done that through history, and it's just an extension of that. So sex comes into it a lot, because I find the function of drawing very close to the function of sex, and the work's often about the need to just put it out there and reproduce constantly, and what meaning it, there is to anything. It's those kind of things I'm interested in. But it's definitely not drawing a specific person.
No. Except with the pieces which I hope some people have had a chance to see in the vitrines, there are your sketchbooks where you are drawing from memory the observation of transvestites in Palermo Park, yeah. Buenos Aires. And that's quite a different approach to still memory.
Well, I think why I started drawing the transvestites that live near me in Buenos Aires is that they gradually became, they were the things that I'd always drawn. They were the living things that I'd always drawn. They altered themselves there rather drastically with surgery. And they were so like the things I'd drawn for decades that I couldn't resist drawing them again. Because they do very subtle variants to themselves. They almost make themselves look like ancient beings. They're very cubist, they're very angular. They've altered themselves through all kinds of different ways. And they do throughout the day when they go out to work. Other than that, it was just a general fascination with beings that can actually have the guts to put themselves in another place and work and function and, you know, have an identity like they do there. And there's a big community there. In Buenos Aires, there's a big thing they call the third sex, which is bisexuality in general. So it's much more evident there than you will ever see it here. So and that in itself is a fascinating thing, because it's something I don't have in England and I don't have access to. And they're like drawings, they're like living drawings, because they alter themselves so radically. So that's why it's fascinating.
Chantal, your subject matter is obviously, as I said, many of the people you know. Yeah. Do you choose to portray or depict particular people? Is it the person you're trying to portray, or is that something more? What is it?
That's quite a hard question. At the moment, I'm painting myself, so that's kind of obvious. Self-portraiture is a good way of trying to understand what's happening in your life.
Sorry,
we
can't hear you.
Sorry. I'm on the moment or even in conversation. I'm just trying to understand my life through self-portraiture. That sounds a bit grandiose, but I find it quite hard to talk about my practice just because sort of making it up as you go along in a way, aren't you, with painting, and trying to, when you over explain it, it sort of, do you know what I mean?
Mm.
It's quite hard.
It seems to me you're very up there after something very real, very, very just what humans are. You're not interested in beautifying them in any way, you just want the reality, the sweat and the smell.
They always look beautiful when I'm drawing them, and then they get offended and I don't. I genuinely don't understand that, because I remember this at college, I painted a friend who was quite chubby, and I found her utterly beautiful. She was red-haired with white eyelashes and blue eyes and had amazing skin. And I always think you paint what you see, or I try to. I found her so beautiful, and then I'd step back and everyone would come and go, oh my God. I don't know. I find it hard to be articulate about how I feel, but I find especially naked people so beautiful that it takes my breath away, and it's hard for me when people say, I mean, I do myself naked, and then they say, oh, you've made yourself look hideous. I don't understand that either, because I'm beautiful to myself when I'm drawing and painting myself, so that's shocking too. And they say, how can you, some people, my partner says, don't show that painting, you've made yourself so hideous, but I don't understand that very much. So I step back sometimes and think, yeah, okay, I sort of see that, but that's honestly.
So there's a sense of always being a bit shocked by the body.
I'm not sure. I find it beautiful, but other people are so, seem quite narrow in their understanding of beauty, I suppose. But maybe they're not, I mean, but you know what I mean.
So is there a formal quality about your work which you're trying to get across, or is it something other than the formal quality that you're trying to get across in your work that people are missing, you feel, or that you...
I never really understand what formal means, to be honest. I'm not being disingenuous, but no.
Okay.
To be honest, every time I start a picture, I want to start it as if I just woke up that day and maybe it'll be better than the day before. And that's all you can ever do. That's the great thing about painting. It's full of hope that the next painting will be better, and you try and paint as if you're somebody else. You know what I mean? And that's the best thing there is about it. But then at the same time, you're in the utterly present tense when you're painting. So it's a sort of weird contradiction, I think. That's the best way I can describe that. The idea of having a practice, that seems old as well, because I suppose you are practicing, but also, anyway, I'm not making a lot of sense, but that's kind of how I see it.
Make perfect.
Sorry?
Make perfect.
And you work with an immediacy as well. But the paint on it, it's almost like one brush to it. Well, this piece is anyway.
I paint very fast.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, the faster it gets, the better. Because that's why I feel close to Sheila sometimes. Not because I feel like I'm in any way like him or something, but I feel his speed, his urgency, his excitement, that's the bit I get or something. And that bit about being the pencil, it's like when you're painting very fast, it's like a frenzy of excitement, and then he adds in his sexual excitement, and it's like as good as it gets or something. But I was saying to Gemma when we were talking that the later work, he's sort of calmed down a bit, and it's not quite as exciting.
Mm-hmm.
It's got a bit sort of, he goes inside the line and he sort of starts, they get more decorative or something.
Mm-hmm.
I think. I still love them, but they don't have that young man's kind of frantic kind of quality.
I think similarly, the way that you often prop your figures, so you don't see the top of the head and the legs get chopped off or propped. There's a sort of intensity in such a short
and it's quite genuinely because this is a very sad answer, but I can never fit anything on, everything gets bigger and bigger. I can't fit them on the page. I never could and I still can't. Which is why the paintings get bigger and bigger, because to fit them on, and I think I'll get the feet in this time and then it's like a sort of brain dysfunction sometimes. Suspect, but there's a brilliant quote from Dago where he says he's going to start today starting from the feet, but again he starts with the head every day. And I really understand, not because I paint like Dago, but because I understand that you always start anyway.
And Stewart, scale is very particular to your work. I mean, you that's the sort of average size piece of work maybe that you've worked on, but you have maybe some amazing long scrolls that go on forever.
The same size.
But the figure is almost the same size.
Well, I think the thing I like is obsessive compulsive behaviour. That's the thing I really want to find in myself and explore. Because for me it is like some horrible compulsion being an artist. You just do this thing over and over again. And in its purest form, it's like a horrible way of knitting your way through life. You know? It's a constant thing. That's the thing that interests me.
But the fingers as well are exquisitely drawn. It's a line. There's no this notion of body form as an outline.
In certainly the later works.
Yeah.
So line is really important. You know, finding a line that can do what I want is the main thrust of it. And the main pleasure that's given back to me when it works. So.
And so is it becomes like a visual language that very stylized, and individual, but each of the figures are just almost the same thing.
Yeah. But I think the things I like are the horrible little habits of human beings and the dark little secrets and finding a line that might be able to express that is something I feel compelled to do. It's the kind of underground society which is what is full in the show. One of the nice things about the show is there's lots of that in all the work. So, it's not exactly heroic. It's the grubby little etching away day by day that you see here of people's need to express something.
And then on each of the works, I think in all cases you have this almost illegible handwriting.
Well, I start by writing always. It's just what I do, and I always have done it. It's normally a line from a song that's on a radio or something that's in my head, and it's just a way of shooting the thing off. So
you actually start with writing first and then drawing?
More than often. I mean, there are drawings that aren't written, but more often. So. And it'll be an observation of many things that I might have seen, or it's a way of cluing it into that day's activity and that day's practice. Day's nasty habit, that kind of.
So it becomes like a diary?
They're always like diaries, yeah.
Do you date them actually?
Sometimes, but not always. I'm not so regimented.
So it's just the fact that you've gone through this day and that's what you've done that day.
It's almost like housework in a way, it's like getting it done and then you can start. Get on to the next thing. It's probably a weird thing to say to somebody who doesn't make work, but. For any artist that does make work, there is a lot of that about continuing to make work from your 20s to your 50s is a very odd turn of phase, really. And you will go through many things to keep it going. And you often have to resort to habit and obsessive compulsive disorders within yourself to keep the thing manifesting over the decades. So, whether or not it's actually a worthwhile or good function is another question. But that's what it feels like to me.
Do you show that?
I was thinking it's like you said a metronome going. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Just like you get yourself going and then from there something happens.
Yeah.
Like you have to combat the kind of empty studio.
Yeah.
You both went to see the Igor Sheila show, which was amazing. Was there a particular work that inspired you in there?
I was particularly blown away by the baby, actually, that newborn baby that he can make a shocking image, not of a woman and her vulva, but of a baby that's. It underlines for me what is about the thing about him is his utter honesty of seeing that's recorded in the drawing. So the baby's like, it's all sort of broken, like it's been flung from somewhere. It's so utterly real and like a newborn. I don't know, it was so moving to me.
And you've painted things, well, you've painted your children as well.
Yeah. It sort of pointed out to me yeah, where I failed really. It kind of, it was everything I've seen when I've looked at a baby, I think. That was, I mean, that's what Sheila does sometimes, isn't it? He's sort of everything you felt, and what all great art does is what you thought you saw. And just the sheer courage to depict the honesty with which you see, that seemed to me the, what he does. He's so utterly clear and brave, and that's a much harder thing to do than it is to say.
I like the last room because I think, because he died so young, you have no idea where he might have gone, and it's almost like he could have become an abstract painter if he'd lived another 20 years, because he's so far out there in his design on the page and his blocking colours. You never know where he might have gone to had he lived. So for me, it would be the last one. Changes on whatever seasonal, you just grab what time you can and you switch off and start drawing. That's my habit. So
you haven't been interested in a studio?
I've never really had a studio. So I've always worked from a domestic situation. Because so. My work's quite small or huge but rolled up, or it doesn't really need a, kind of a nice idea. In London it's quite a luxury.
And Chantal,
I go in every day. I get there at 9:45, and then I work, and then I go home. It's a really interesting description. Riveting.
But your studio is sort of almost a classic.
A cliche,
it's completely cluttered and the floor is just full of images and magazines, pages pulled out of magazines and fashion, it's amazing.
It's a place I love to be. It's such a great place to go to and be. I love it.
And a private place.
Yeah, it's completely private. Your own. I used to have studios in those blocks where they had the half, not quite a wall, which, you know, where there was constant noise and bothering with other people's music, which I didn't like very much. I sound like Sheldon on the Big Bang Theory. It's a great reference.
I meant to actually ask you, Stuart, a little bit more about the drawings, that they seem to be about sex, but they're not, in a sense. There's no sexual act.
No, they're more often about the bits before or after sex, the embarrassment of people, they can't quite get to it, the habit of it, the relentlessness of it. It's the little spaces in between that I'm interested in. Rather than overt sexuality being portrayed on a page, it's the little things that aren't spoken about and the often the wretchedness of it, you know, the wretchedness of mankind's desire to find sex all the time is the thing that kind of really interests me. So
that's what drives them to do this.
Yeah. Because I think it's like set drawing is, many artists have said this, but drawing is painting is a bit like sex. You know, it's a very indulgent and self-satisfying activity. The majority of the time doesn't mean anything to anyone else at all. So there's lots of analogies.
So you probably share what Dave was saying earlier about the naked body being like, the drawing being like a naked body. And they're both revealing. The drawing is the idea of revealing something.
Or literally revealing something to you. Yeah, it often gives a lot to you. Mm. You know, there's a function for it within yourself, because the activity that tells you lots of things about yourself and about your need to do it, or your observations in the world, or, you know, it does have that dual thing.
And also nobody else having, I thought that was really interesting about the Egon Schiele, that you roll them up and they were, that's the whole thing about drawing a pie, and it belongs in, you know, you can throw it away or hide it or scrumple it, or it's such a private thing. Mm. And when you look at your own drawings again, you get surprised, don't you, by, I don't know, what you chose to draw or how you, I don't know, they're the things that surprise you, I think.
Yeah. The freedoms you find that it gave to you, the things that the thing gives back to you are the things that interest me. So, because it is a strange activity to draw for 35 years, is it? A twisted activity, really. So, but it's something humans have always done. So, you know, right to prehistoric times. So it's a, feels a very natural thing and a very unnatural thing at the same time, and that's the duality that I kind of like.
Mm-hmm. And you do drawings as well, of course. Lots of them.
Yeah, I like, I'm just, while you were talking, I was thinking about the drawings you do that you never show that are, in a way, the most, not useful, but just kind of, like of awful, awful times in your life, terrible things, I don't know, like a trip to the gynecologist or something hideous, but you try and draw the angle or something of the awfulness, and or, and they're really gripping to me when I look at them, and I, you don't want to show them to anybody else, but they are gripping, and urgent, and it's a strength that you have.
I always put mine away to cook for a couple of years, as I call it, so I put them away in a wardrobe, and then a couple of years later I get them out, and then I'm prepared to see if they're any good or not. So. But the other side of things is I'm very hooked on getting a line the way I want it. It's one of my things, and that wouldn't be true of everyone in the show. So.
No, I mean, you're completely approach.
Completely
to
different. It's a bit like putting them away to prove so they can rise. And they're often the ones you think are good or terrible when you see them again, and you know, there's lots of that. So. It is a bit like a compulsive disorder, really. It's like cleaning the house every day, or, you know. Once you go in it for the long term, it's a very strange activity.
Twisting again, like a lot of things.
because the one, it's a bit like a drawing because it's all one, you know, cut.
Yeah.
Not, no correction. I like that in Sheila that he doesn't correct. He doesn't correct. They are one.
Are you pleased we included it in the show?
Yeah, yeah.
Because it's something that's very discarded, really. It's so nice to see it here in the context of the rest of the world.
Yeah, no, it's beautiful. Beautiful.
We can invite everyone. That's all. Thank you.
If anyone's got any questions or to address to the panel or any further issues that you'd like to raise, then fire away.
I sort of know the answer because I spoke to David, but I'd like to hear more about how all these people in the exhibition have kind of felt and responded when they were asked to put in the show in this context. Being the
reference. I think that's a question to David.
How did artists feel to be in the exhibition?
They responded when they asked them to be in the show.
So to be included in the show that had Sheila as a sort of starting point, how did artists feel about it?
Well, strangely, people agreed to be in it, which was kind of nice to start off with. And one of the big shocks was I really didn't think that people would admit to even liking Sheila because Sheila's a bit of a first crush for a lot of artists. He's often the first, like Stewart says, it's often the first book a lot of people get. And if you're, especially if you're working class, like say like me and Stewart, you know, we didn't really see art when we were teen, you know. Growing up, so often you go on to art college, and that's one of the first things you see, and you relate to him, I guess, because he's young and you know, cool shoes and stuff, good hair, and so a lot of artists, I think, kind of deny this boy band crush a little bit, and then what's quite surprising is that when you talk to them, I was quite surprised at how many admitted it to it, and for instance, Rosemary. In answer to one of Gemma's questions, said exactly that her mother had given her a book on Sheila, and it had changed her relationship both to her mother and her feelings about art forever.
Yeah.
And so that was quite surprising that a lot of the artists, but what we did have was that, and Marlene Dumas, very, you know, she talks very beautifully about Sheila. But on the whole, everyone asked who was alive was extremely generous and extremely keen to be in this show. And I think they recognized the subject matter and what we were trying to get at.
I can't help but I just slightly want to take Sheila out for a moment because all these works in here. Kind of talking to one another, and I'm just wondering, I was thinking about the artists who are just speaking this evening, Chantal, what work here is connecting with what you're doing, apart from through the thread of Sheila. I don't know who referenced Spiro works, and connected one of your work, I think, connecting to the Spiro, and to me that's like a kind of zinging line across the whole of the gallery, it's, you know, there's some other things going on here, and I just wondered, where your work was connecting, where else it's connecting, right here with all this?
Well, for me it's through his, you know, they're very interested in references from history and the dynamics of history throughout ages rather than doing the dynamics truly. The nice thing about the show here for me was, the good thing about the drawing room is that they give voice to that kind of grubby little behaviour that artists involve themselves in, and they're able to not shy away from it. And it's, you know, lots of the things they show here are about that little, the activity of drawing, the wide range of practices it has. And you can see it all through the room.
No, I agree. The Sheila point is the start and the end of the show, but that's what it was. You know, then, of course, it was the development of how these artists work, relate to each other. you know, and also not exactly how they relate just to each other, but how they relate to art history in general. You know, there were certain people like Pontormo, for instance, and for us, like Greek classicism, and all sorts of things that started to feed into the, you know, the choice of the, so hopefully that they're not, hopefully they're engaged with each other in this exhibition, but they're engaged with that, you know, with other artists throughout history who have engaged with the subject. But I agree, there are lots of nice, not just that one, there's lots of like threads, you know, you can make a web across the show of, you know, the way, you know, way, and a lot of that's to do with the hanging as well. And some of those things you don't even really see. It's weird when you write and say the book, because you don't have the work really in front of you. You sort of write, you know, you write the bits you're getting, you know, and try and put it together in your head. And then when you get the work here and you start to put it up, then of course it's a joy.
She said just in connection with that, that I didn't have any experience of hanging as we hung here at Drawing Room before, so it was a really important process for me to go through. Whenever I've curated exhibitions in the past, I've had to do a paper hang. Do you know what I mean by a paper hang? Where all of the work is cut out to scale in craft paper and then stuck up with blue tack with the you know, the text, the whole text next to it. And so you're deciding on how an exhibition is going to, how the display is going to work, you know, with brown craft paper. Whereas here, and that's because, you know, work comes with couriers and it has to be installed whilst the courier is there, and you can't put them up more than two nights in London, and, you know, very good reasons for that. But what was wonderful about working here at Drawing Room is that, by and large, the work was unpacked and put in the centre of the room. And David, with help from Kate and Mary, thought about the poetic relationships between objects, and the display wasn't decided on until the work was unpacked and here in the gallery space. And that's a far more creative approach to curating, and something I think that you can only do when you're working on this scale. It's very difficult to do that kind of thing at the National Gallery, for example.
Okay, yeah, I guess that's a curating question you've answered. I guess I was asking an artist response to their own work to things that are here. You know, there's something here that is, else has come in that's connected to your work in a particular way.
I mean, is there something that resonates?
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's
new,
unexpected something.
I really like Franz West, and I really love that. I was just thinking I like the paint on the panels red and go.
No, that is.
Can I ask a really practical question from you, Chantal? Painting from the three-dimensional live figure to become deeply untrending, and, well, okay, that's what I do, and I find it is now not the first thing people ask for when they put an exhibition on.
Yeah.
Okay, so you work from two-dimensional images as well.
Yeah.
Do you find there's a big difference between doing something from a 3D live person or doing something from a pornographic sort of flat two-dimensional?
Yeah, there's a very big difference. I mean, the weird bit is when you have to deal with the person. I mean, that for me is, I find really hard, partly because they talk a lot, and that's really annoying after 5 hours talking. And also they make you do stuff. Like one of my models kept going, oh, I love that blanket, leave it like that, which is immensely irritating. And you know, it's an interactive experience without messing with a stone person. So that can be good and bad. It's kind of interesting, but good and bad.
I'd love to be able to work from a two-dimensional image, but the volume of that person and the presence of that person is incredibly important when I'm working.
Yeah.
So if I could only work from 2D, I'd be much happier because I could work much faster. And
say, yeah, no, it's a completely different experience. And you're right, not just the fact that they talk, but the actual stuff of them, the being and the movement and the everything. I've been doing self-portraits from life, and you're left with the terrible thing that you've always got that real cliche of, you know, you and then they are moving off the camp. You know, there's all kinds of strange, or it's very distorted because you're moving. You know, there's lots of different, whereas with a photograph it's completely different. I mean, there's the brilliant Bacon quote, but basically I can do horrible things to my friends from a photo that I can't do if I had them there, you know. But then Lucian Freud can manage to do pretty horrible, you know.
Thank you.
Neil,
you had a question?
Yeah, well, it was more of, it was like a kind of observation or a three-part question observation thing about, well, I was thinking about looking at the Egon Schiele drawing in there, and I thought, well, I still think, I don't think that's a self-portrait, I think that's, I don't think that's it. And then, because I thought, well, I don't think he would draw his own genitals that way, and then I sort of think, well, it's all about, I think about how he draws himself masturbating, and I thought, well, it's actually a question about masturbation and about drawing and the male artist. I was thinking about what Robert Hughes said about Robert Crumb in the Crumb film. He talks about Robert Crumb's drawings as being an aid to masturbation, and this relationship of drawing and, yeah, that for men, obviously it's a very different, I know I'm kind of approaching kind of dodgy ground, but certainly, I think about Warhol's drawing, those to me are conveyed to masturbation, as Franz West is. I don't think Chris is in that way, I don't think Boyce is about that. But I think there's something, well, I just wonder what your thoughts are about that. I think it's about that.
I think I'll let the ladies
answer that. And I think there's something about drawing. Drawing is something about the touch of the pencil or the on paper. There's something in that, and there's something about, yeah.
Well, I think Stewart's very much spoke about that already.
I think the drawing is like masturbating. I mean, it is the masturbation. Right. For me, you know, drawing is like masturbating. So.
Stewart, you describe it really beautifully as this relationship between the line and the lust, and those two things are continually weaving in and out of each other.
But there's not a lot of analogies with masturbating and drawing for me.
Can I just ask something to the panel about, do they feel that as artists and curators that there's a different postmodern view of the figure, whether that be male, female figure, when they're painting now? Do you think that, because obviously she is a modernist painter, and I'm just wondering whether you feel that now artists are working on viewing the figure in a different way than an art history point of view.
I want to go back to the masturbating question. I think it's because it's actually, it puts its finger far more on the crux of it than your question does, just to, you know, in a way, because about what art is. Mm. And because masturbation goes hand in hand with goes hand in hand with imagination and desire, and that internal, you know, the way of fantasy and fantasizing, that there's something. And so poor Neil's run off. But there's something so interesting, and that is a fundamental thing about what this exhibition is. It's that, and that's why so much of the work here feels like it's transgender as well. There's a fluidity. So this thing about male and female, when you look at an awful lot of the drawings and an awful lot of the works in this room, there's a fluidity of gender, which I think the imagination, mm-hmm. you know, after all, we were all the same once. And I think it's there, you know, it's, and I think that's the interesting thing. And so, I think Neil Priest's been doing, and that's why he's been trying to put this together, why he's been watching, you know, the whole
They're just, I mean, as an art student now, there just seems to be this huge taboo still, in my experience, about figuring the human form, whether it be male or female. At a time when there's more imagery around to access about masturbation or sex or whatever else, people are even more shy about thinking.
Is that not to do with art education?
I don't know. I'm asking you. I'd
be interested to know because I know that it's.
Well, you should always disagree with everything everyone tells you about art college. So don't, I mean, I wouldn't, you know, I mean, on the whole, it's generally, you know, most of what people say.
No, I'm so, not talking, I'm talking about from a student's point of view. There seems to be this kind of reticence to actually get in and paint and walk.
Well, I don't know.
Because
really.
There's a shyness about it.
We just don't know how to teach it anymore because no one learns how to do it anymore. But it's been part of that. I think, you know, I teach both contemporary and figurative. And I think a lot of the newer tutors who come in, they're very much towards conceptual drawing, which I love, but they can't actually do for that. That's not me, you know.
Have we got any more questions? Yes. There's sort of striking person on the
My question to John about Nancy. You said she was diagnosed with an alcoholic condition. Did that affect like the way she worked, her urgency of work?
Did it affect what, sorry?
The urgency of the way she worked and how she did she feel like she needed to work quicker, but she was having a good day with it, or because she knew she was gonna get worse.
Well, sometimes it did, sometimes it didn't. I mean, given the subject matter, which over a 50-year period was the representation of the woman as victim through to the notion of kind of empowered female image, then I think certainly there is a way which at a symbolic level her own sense of corporeality was, you know, was there in her practice. And I think that the point at which she realised that her prints could actually be done on walls, there was both a very telling, but I think also a very touching sense of her freeing her body through that process of symbolisation. You know, she was escaping the restrictions of that. And occupy the space in a way in which physically, of course, she wasn't able to occupy the space. So yes, I mean, I think those correspondences there. I mean, I think it's difficult to talk about that relationship between, you know, the individual sense of embodiment and how that becomes part of the practice. On the other hand, I think it is fundamental, and it's certainly fundamental if you're going to talk about the kind of materiality of the practice. But on a very crude level, she had good days and bad days. But she also had an indomitable will. I mean, I never met anybody, any artist, or anybody actually, who was able to so make her physical experience, her relationship to the world, subject to what it was she wanted to realise and make. And that went right throughout her life, right through, you know, to, you know, the end of her life.
John, can I ask you, what do you think she would have thought about being in this exhibition?
She'd have loved it. I mean, something that always impressed me is that they're always also very, very responsive to young artists.
Mm.
I mean, they're really very much enjoyed. I mean, you know, they have a system in the States where students can go and study with artists, you know, work with artists for, you know, weeks or even months in their studio, and they enjoyed that. They constantly, over the 25 years that I knew them and worked with them, had an endless stream of people who they worked with. And she knew a lot of young artists, she encouraged young artists, she exchanged works. And I think she'd have been very happy being here.
And what about Egon Schiele? What was he an artist that they talked about?
No, not to me. I mean, they would certainly, I mean, Leon had an immense art historical knowledge. I mean, he really had an immense art historical, but generally he had an extraordinary curiosity. Nancy was more focused. He was very broad in his range of references and interests. So he would have known about Sheila's work. But it wasn't something that, I mean, actually, when I saw the Matisse exhibition, I kind of wished that I'd had that conversation with Nancy about Matisse, because I couldn't recall a time at which she said Matisse was important or she'd looked at Matisse in a particular way and taken some of Matisse. But I did feel that there were correspondences there that were very important. But can I just say, I would say your question about postmodern subject, I mean, actually, I think we kind of representation of the self would of course change and shift historically. So there's a kind of question about, you know, to what extent is a Sheila drawing a drawing of that particular, you know, of the 19th century or 20th century, and what extent is, you know, one of the contemporary drama named Duma, something that is very much about, you know, the sense of embodiment. That is, of course, a 21st century sense of embodiment. So yeah, I mean, I would imagine you go around and you would historically be able to see those shifts.
One of the things we haven't said about the show is there's actually a lot of humour in the show. Nearly everyone's work has a kind of ironic, humorous tone to it.
You talked a little bit about the notion of expression earlier, and I was just thinking about the notion of transgression, because that's obviously the title of the something I've read around the show today. And I just wanted to know what you kind of think of as transgression now, and if it's really possible.
Where did you say transgression?
That's the title. Thank you. Expression and transgression. It was meant today.
Who read that?
Naughty, which I like, but go on, so much.
I'm really interested in how Sheila was transgressive, and how with his life drawing he was continually testing these limits between what was acceptable and what was unacceptable, and they mapped onto other issues like what was art and what was pornography, and what was obscene and what was or what was abject and what was whole. And I think what I find so compelling is how he's continually trying to push those boundaries. His work has been described as pushing the limits of the exhibitable, and I think that's a really good way of describing it. And in my work, you know, I'm always trying to go back through exhibition reviews, you know, moments when his work was shown in public in Vienna in 1910, 1912, and to try and reconstruct through that early reception history why he was so transgressive. And I think his transgressive elements have been sort of dampened down through this mid to late 20th century reception, which has tried to actually make Sheila safe and has tried to think about his work in terms of the eternal erotic, in terms of the nude. What I try to do in my work by looking at the relationship between his drawings and pornographic photography at the time is to really show how, is to try and get us back to the original shock of his work, to try and return to what made it so transgressive then.
Is it possible now? It's kind of, it's an argument.
Is it possible to be like that now?
Is transgression, is the idea of a you know, Sheila making that work then, there was something, there was a shock and there was a new. Is that still possible? It's an argument I have all the time with people.
This was partly my question.
It's something I think about a lot, because I would like to know that it is possible. I'd like to believe that it is possible. And I'm trying to work out for myself, you know, how would I define transgressive now? So I would think of it as something that was familiar made unfamiliar, remade into the familiar, or the other way around, unfamiliar to familiar, and then unfamiliar again. So it's kind of pushing on from that idea, which is something that is shocking at the moment. Does that make sense? So that's how I...
Why would anyone want to make something shocking?
Well, what does transgressive mean?
In some strange way, this is where I do disagree with John and about this, because I think art is like a time machine, and I think artists, particularly artists themselves, look at art from different periods of time as if it's in their own time. It's how it works. It's like, and you're often a conduit for these things going through. And I often feel that I don't think artists set out to shock at Cool. I know, are you an artist yourself?
I am an artist.
And, I mean, that's interesting because often the artist doesn't set out to shock himself. And I've never actually found Sheila's drawings shocking.
No.
Even when I saw them, I just thought they were, they had an honesty about them. And I think that, that's a difference. I didn't see them, they were trans. It's all about
transgressive.
I didn't see that they were transgressive in any way. I saw them, and even now, I, my time machine starts going into action, and I see Japanese shunga, you know, prints, and I see, you know, ancient things, and I see the murals in Pompeii, and, you know, and there's many, many things on that level, you know. So,
well, you said to me in the past that there's no such thing as a dead artist to you, and that, you know, that artists are able, in ways that art historians find very difficult, to make these leaps across periods, centuries, and to find the connections and to actually think of themselves all as each other's contemporaries.
So would it be some kind of, to you, Chantal, you were talking about the kind of raw honesty or the clear way of seeing, in a sense, just get this term transgression, it bothers me, is the same kind of thing. Is it about that? Is it delving down to that point of kind of raw delivery?
You know what, I bet if you did something as honest, if you, sorry.
It's raw.
I get excited.
Maybe shocking is the wrong word, but astonishing maybe. They're astonished at that show. It's astonishing in a way that, I don't know, I don't think anything that's been made since the whole world was astonishing in that particular way that, like, children, the sick child is astonishing. It's a naked child with a sort of, it's astonishing image. It's not shocking, but the sheer honesty is astonishing.
Well, I would agree that anything made in honesty is going to be transgressive to someone. You know, that's what it does, doesn't it?
Do you think that the gallery art is a very characteristic of the animal
that you might
have? Sheila drawing, they seem to have a strong, honest reaction, like really straight into you, because there's also, they refer first to the animal in us, and then you. They keep something that becomes is before being human. Does that make any sense?
Does he mean, are they animalistic?
Yeah.
What, you mean they appeal to something basic in our nature?
Yeah. Before anything else.
I think there is something about all great art which is, it's something we've already seen, we've recognised, I think that's true. I think you recognise something, it's an echo of something you've seen, I think that's true. I think we've all looked at ourselves naked, maybe a bit, maybe not for me, like Egon, because I don't have a penis, but you know, that looking in the mirror, sort of astonished, you know, I think.
Explore.
Yeah, I think so, yes, I guess.
I think it might be why, some art critic described Stubbs' whistle jacket as being like a nude. You can't hear it. Stubbs' whistle jacket, a picture of the horse, that's been described as a nude, and it's always been seen as a metaphor for a nakedness, some way, which I think is really interesting because it's, in a way, Stubbs wasn't able to paint nakedness or nudity or anything like that. So he's turned to the kind of viscerality of animal flesh, which I think, I always think about it in this kind of context, because it's, in a way, it's a similar way of an artist looking. I don't know if it is. Which is why that painting is so imposing. It's so much about how humans look at themselves, down to the basic facts that we're blood and muscle and bone, and it's a miracle that we all managed to communicate.
Like Sheila, then it's just on that. It's only that itself rather than the background.
Mm. Yeah.
Mm.
It's sheer kind of
isolated, isn't it? Canvas.
But it's also about that. I mean, we've been talking about it's about the discomfort of the viewer, isn't it, as well? I think what somebody was saying to me about the Sheila exhibition, I've been very lucky to see it twice when it's been quite empty. And somebody was saying to me they find it really uncomfortable being with lots of other people, and you're sort of thrust, you know, kind of almost kind of locked into this position. And it's a very different experience of looking. So I think that's also a factor in where the experience of actually encountering the work as well. So I think, you know, these
I don't know what other people. I mean, this is where it might be interesting to think a little bit about the importance or otherwise of the wall text and how that mediates your experience of the work of art. And there aren't any wall texts here. At the courtyard for the Radical Nude exhibition, there is a wall text for every single work, and the wall texts are written by Barnaby Wright, the Dan Katz curator of 20th century art there. And they're incredibly interesting to read because you sense, and I hope Barney actually did film, I hope Barney won't be saying this, but you get this sense in the wall text of his incredible anxiety about how the viewer might respond to the work of art, and that possibly that response might be what inappropriate for a gallery space. So the wall texts are these, you know, incredibly accomplished and insightful formal analyses of everything except what you are looking at. So the line, the colour, the contour, the shadow, the sheet, the perspective, the pencil, the gouache, you know, everything except the body, the vulva, the age of the model, the penis, you know, everything except what you're actually looking at. And you know, that's something I think we did very well to resist that here, and to just actually let the works speak for themselves and for people to discern the relationships for themselves between images.
There's a book by James Elkin some years ago called The Object Stares Back, mm-hmm. and he asked that question, is there such a thing as an unbearable image? Mm-hmm. I mean, I think it's different if we talk about the image within the context of art or outside of it. I mean, we know there are unbearable, certainly images that won't be shown. Look at ISIS. And look at the pictures, the documents of you know, the beheading of their victims. They don't show the beheading, although it is available on YouTube. You can go and see it. And I mean, in this, he says that the only image he came across that was an unbearable image was an image of the torture of a woman in China who was having parts of her body gradually removed, and the photograph showed him the different stages, and he's actually physically unable to look at that image, although of course you are drawn back to it.
Is that the Bataille image? It's in the Bataille, isn't it?
Yeah.
Bataille used it, that's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
John, there are a lot of beheadings in the history of art.
Oh yeah. The severed head, Julie Christo, who did a whole exhibition of the Louvre on the severed head.
I mean, because it's art, it's the art itself.
But that's what
it's,
I mean.
It's the sort of barrier, I suppose, the thing that, you know, it's like showing them many, many terrifying played alive, decapitated, raped.
Yes. Yeah.
And all in the National Gallery.
Yeah. In art, it's okay. It's different outside.
Yeah. it's interesting though, because the only real place you do get wall texts and exhibitions are in public institutions, often with public money.
Yeah.
It's because it is a safeguard. It's the thing. You know, I think on the whole, most private collections, most private exhibitions, galleries don't feel the necessity to properly have that fallback.
But there is, I think, whenever you see Sheila's work on display, and this is in museums connected to private foundations, including the Leopold in particular in Vienna, there is an excessive amount of wall text, because I think there is an anxiety about how to bring this work into Vienna, how to explain it, how to justify it, how to ensure it has this particular status.
And apparently people have
Well, that's because they came to the court hall. They probably thought they were going to go see some nuns.
Well, and I think, you know, when I was talking about art students today, there's this anxiety, there's this definite anxiety about how, particularly new women painters, for example, would get on and actually use the female form in particular, but also the male form as well, and it's about how you go around doing that in the 21st century with all these sensibilities about, you know, somebody like Sheila, who is a fantastic icon, the human figure, and we're still reacting to him like that, his work like this. This is what I was trying to get at, is, you know, I love figuring the human form, and I'm trying to find my avenue now into it and try to contextualise it in the 21st century.
But would you go to prison for that? I mean, he went to prison.
He did, yeah, I know, he went to prison. Would I go to prison for that? No, I wouldn't.
Well, it's absurd now. You think we just have to look on YouTube, you can find the most horrific images.
Absolutely. It's so absurd.
I mean, it's what Jake and Dinos' work is all about, isn't it? That how awful they can be, and the art sphere still manages to contain it.
But Richard Prince didn't contain it. Richard Prince's image broke too. It doesn't, it does, stuff does tip, doesn't it? And people do start to say, this is wrong. I don't know, it's funny.
One sense it's made kind of accepted, hasn't it? Shifted into a different context.
Yeah, I think an artist like Paul McCartney probably still pretty much close to the mark, actually, when it comes to some of those films and performances, and they're really quite brilliant, but they really do, you know, really do push the, you know, and I think part of it maybe is a genuine one, you know, to push that shock, whatever. But I think in this show, I think not to lose sight of what the show is in some way, I don't think there's anything inherently shocking in this exhibition itself. I think this is very much about, it is about the body, what it's like to be inside a body. It's like, you know, observe another body. I mean, that's what it's about. It's about the vulnerability of our fragile state within, you know, without, really.
Yeah, and when we went to visit Enrico David, he said, for me, art is about a willingness to be, being prepared to be embarrassed. So, you know, I make, you know, through my work, I'm prepared to be embarrassed. And I think we were thinking about that. That was, he was one of the kind of early studio visits that he made, and I think that kind of formed, it's just that openness, you know, that being prepared to be embarrassed in public, if you like, through your art, you know, something that just feels very kind of genuine and very vulnerable as well. I think it's one of the things that
it's more like, I mean, the like what Stewart was saying, is that you can't help but do embarrassing things, you know? I mean, these rooms rooms full of artists, you know, lifting their skirts and opening their raincoats, you know? It's a kind of compulsion. It's there, and that's part of it. And of course it goes off in many, many different directions. It works in a much more political say than going in that direction. It works to do with history, it works to do with sexuality, and all sorts of things. But I think there is a common thread as well that runs through them, that I always find it very odd that people use words like courage and that, because it's, you know, to do with art, because, I mean, it's not like being a soldier or going down a coal mine. I mean, but there is an element of bravery, I think, in a lot of the artists' work.
Shall we finish that? Anybody's got a burning question? So, I'd like to thank all of our participants very much for their contributions, and thank you all very much for